The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Rollins and Kevin Laramée, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night, and welcome to Soccer Today for Thursday, June 3rd, 2020. Breaking news, Major League Soccer and the Major League Soccer Players Association have agreed, Duane. The new CBA has been voted on last night and this morning and has been ratified by the league and by the players, according to Paul Tenorio of The Athletic, and more details are to come. So we suggest you subscribe to The Athletic and you follow Paul's work all day long. But according to Paul Tenorio of The Athletic, Major League Soccer and Major League Soccer Players Association have ratified a new CBA. We will have a tournament in Orlando. It is official.
Yeah, we should quickly mention Sam Stejskal is also bylined on the piece that in The Athletic things are breaking fast. So it's hard to know exact from moment to moment. But I think you should circle July 11th on your calendar if you're an MLS fan. Because basically they're going back on June 27th is what the in or around they say, but that weekend gives players time to get some stuff in line. 2 weeks of training, which is shorter than the duration that we had initially heard. I think that if you look back, the best comparison I can do in the past for that length of a training camp after a long delay after starting would be the NHL lockout. And it was 11 days was how long they went into training camp. So it fits that kind of a little bit longer than that even. So it should be possible to do. So the 11th of July, which will be not quite, just 2 days shy of 4 months of the shutdown of the league. So we can see the end of it now. Now, Kevin, I don't want to celebrate this so much as just act as like it's, I'm relieved more than excited by it. I'm happy to see a pathway to playing back again. Hopefully that, you know, we're through the worst of the COVID-19 issues. I'm not a doctor who said that 1,000 times, you know, how in the past, you know, points in the border, points in the pocket would be our t-shirt slogan or various other things. I think I'm not a doctor will be our 2020 t-shirt slogans really. So we don't know, but it looks to me like the examples we're seeing around the world that if they get back in the summer, barring something catastrophic on the health front, they will be able to take this year through to a finish and that we can get back to watching what we love. And this is, look, I don't want to be tone deaf. We all understand what's happening in the world and we addressed it on Monday. So all of this is casting a shadow over my excitement, but I still think we can allow ourselves a moment to be happy that something we love is coming back.
Yeah, well, for sure. And it's going to come back, like we say, probably around June, July 11th. And by the end of June, training will resume. Of course, yesterday was the same as the day before. Tuesday, Wednesday, players did not go for the individual voluntary workout sessions that were planned. But there were some breakthroughs happening during yesterday's show. If you go back to yesterday, listening to Jeffrey Carlisle of ESPN, who was literally breaking news also on our show yesterday. Thanks to Jeff. Yesterday's show was biggest show in the history of soccer. Today is trending to be the same. And we thank every single one of you for being with us during these newsworthy time in Major League Soccer. But the CBA has been ratified for sure. I think we have to give credit to The Athletic all throughout this. And even when they were put on the spot by Major League Soccer's Commissioner Don Garber, continued to do great reporting. Paul Tenorio, Sam Stejskal, Jeff Rader are great soccer writers for The Athletic, and we have the chance to have them on the show from time to time. And, of course, we like their work, so we suggest that you go subscribe to The Athletic, get all the details there. I don't want to necessarily mention all the details here, but we're looking at a salary cut to players, which is newsworthy, at around 7.5%, Duane. That's a far cry from the 50% that we've heard at the beginning of these negotiations with the league and such. So those are positive notes for the players. And if you were looking at MLS and MLSPA, these numbers evolved from 50%, which were rumored at the beginning, to 30% to now all the way to 7.5%.
Yeah, and I'm still not entirely clear on whether there's a cap at 100,000 like the initial or whether this is across the board, meaning that if you make less than 100 grand a year that you'll be protected from your entire income. I hope for this player's case that's the case, but I'm not entirely sure. But for sure, there has been, I think, a significant win on the player's front when it comes to protecting their salaries. 7.5% kit is not something anyone would sniff at. I mean, that's your cell phone bill, right? Or whatever, like pick a utility. So it's not something you want to completely dismiss out of hand, but within the context of the world at large, you know, and when we talked yesterday about CanPL players, which make far less money facing a 30% cut, and maybe we'll address that in the second half of the show. We have a little bit, maybe we can talk about there, but that's a significant win for the players. And I think it reflects a couple things, both the power of their association within Major League Soccer to fight for their rights, which is very important. And also I think it reflects the changing and evolution of the health situation.
Of the ownership situation too. If we go back to what Jeffrey Carla was saying yesterday, Duane, there was dissension in the ownership group. Some new owners, so when you say new owners, we're obviously thinking LAFC, Atlanta, Nashville, Miami. Owners that have a lot of stake in the short term view this very differently than the Robert Krafts and the Hunts, you know. So maybe this is the result of that dissension also.
Yeah, well, for 100%, you know, and when it comes to the overall movement of the CBA, we talked a lot about the CBA at the time that it was ratified, or not ratified, that it was agreed upon back in the day, and we were actually doing a show while it broke. I think it happened during the show, if memory serves. So, yeah, we've already addressed that, but to suggest that there's kind of an increasing split between the haves and have-nots, or the new and the old, or the rich and the poor, or whatever you want to classify it as. And, you know, on Friday, or on Saturday, I should say, when they rejected the players' counterproposal outright and threatened lockout, I think that was coming from the old voices, and then the new voices jumped in, as Jeff said the other day, and you have a little bit of drama there. What I meant by the health situation playing a role, too, is I think back when we initially heard that 50%, they were suggesting that there wouldn't be any games at all, and that they were offering maybe half their salary to keep them under contract for the year when they wouldn't play anything. And now it looks like we might get maybe close to 20 in and then a playoff. That is a far cry from 34 in a playoff, but it's not as damaging, as bad as we thought it would be at the start of this. And, you know, if you're listening to this and you're a person who likes to look at the negatives, you might be screaming at your device about how you know, a second wave could hit in the fall, and that's absolutely possible, but we don't know.
It's always a caveat. Yeah, right, Duane? It's on everything we're talking about in this show, that's always the caveat for, of course. It's like the asterisk on anything planned for the next year, right? If the pandemic lets us do it, if a second wave doesn't hit, if, of course.
Yeah, no, 100%. And look, I think that at this point in this, we are what? March. I went into quarantine on March the 8th. So, and it is now June the 3rd. So,
and I were early. We were like a week early. I think March 13th, that Thursday, which is now considered a big moment in sports history, is one of the few times where all the sports leagues shut down at the same time. So that's on Thursday, March 13th, I believe.
Yeah. It doesn't matter. Early March. The point I'm making is that we've been all doing this for 3-4 months now. We understand the danger of it. We don't need to, you know, underline everything with lessons about being careful about public health, either you're on board with it or not at this point. So we all get that. So the rest of the, you know what, moving forward, let's just assume you understand that caveat in it, okay? We get that public health plays first
yeah,
role.
Yeah, on everything.
Yeah. Like I said, I mean, I'm not excited per se today, because this is just one small step, and we're, you know, until I see those players, until the whistle blows, and just like Germany, right? I wasn't ready to say it was back until I saw the ball kicked off, and I was like, okay, now we have our soccer back. And it would be the same with England on June 17th, when I see the Powder Blues kick a ball for the first time, it'll feel a little bit more normal, and then go forward to July 11th, I believe, which is a Saturday, when I suspect that they will kick this thing off, then I'll be like, okay, we're ready to go. And look, for sports fans, it's going to be a fun few months from July forward once you get past the no crowds thing. And I think most of us have accepted that now. And I found this week has felt the most normal of all. Each week feels a little more normal to me, Kevin. And with the Bundesliga, I'm still watching a lot of it, but I don't feel like a desperate need to watch every second of it anymore. Yeah. If I have some of the stuff to do, I'll turn it on and have it in the background. And it's like normal again, right? Like, you don't watch every second of every game because, I mean, I'm sure some of you do, but you can't. And it's kind of back to that. And the more this moves forward, the better it feels. But look, good for the MLS to get this done. I'm sad that it came to like the whole lockout threats and the players. Yeah. Obviously, calmer heads prevailed.
Yeah, I agree.
And that's the important thing.
You would hope that that a lot of people could learn from this situation. And yeah, calmer heads did prevail, Major League said. And logic prevailed too, right? Which I think is also something important. So once again, Major League Soccer and the Major League Soccer Players Association have voted and ratified the new CBA players last night and this morning, and the owners also. According to Paul Tenorio and Sam Stejskal of course, The Athletic. And if you want to listen to Sam Stejskal of The Athletic, he was on The Scrum Podcast last week, special show on Thursday, and of course on Monday, great show by Julian and Tristan, talking about the fallout of George Floyd's death, and a great, not easy, but a important conversation to listen to between Julian and Tristan on Monday's The Scrum, which I very, very hardly suggest. Of course, Duane, before we take a break and talk about the Canadian Premier League and some news on that side and the fallout of course, of yesterday's show. Also, when we're looking at, we know that there will be also a Canadian Premier League. So, well, Canadian Championship, I mean. Yesterday, we've talked about the communication and a lot of between the players and the league and what could happen and the salary cuts. And we'll get there after the break. And we'll talk about Ryan Telfer after the break also. But before, because it does touch Major League Soccer, and we'll see if they are actually involved, but there is a plan in place for a 2020 Canadian Championship.
Yeah, I mean, we should be careful to say absolutes here as anything, because this is all dependent on the Canadian Premier League getting its plan in place. But because there is less labor oversight there, for better or worse, they likely will forge ahead, forgive the pun, if you know CanPL, you know that's a pun, forge ahead with the plan. Yes, they are looking to... The Canadian Premier League plan is basically this. They want, if you didn't listen to yesterday's show real quickly, they're looking to play in a single site tournament. It would be like the NWSL, its entire season. They are now not looking at doing two different things or coming back in the fall, just rather having a tournament for a month and then refocusing on 2021. It's not ideal, obviously, from a fan perspective, but it might be the best that is possible. The plan from the Canadian Premier League also includes provisions to allow their teams to be in peak form at the end of it, so that they can then continue on and immediately start playing in the Canadian Championship. We don't know what that format looks like yet. There are 8 teams in the Canadian Premier League. You would assume that you could simply have a 8-4-2-1 situation with the CanPL teams and plug them down to a single team, and then perhaps bring a Major League Soccer teams in. I don't know how the MLS teams, maybe they have a little tournament themselves when they're down in Florida. That's a possibility. None of this has come out yet. But there is absolutely a plan and a desire to also play the Voyageurs Cup this year, and it would happen immediately following the tournament that takes place in either PEI or Victoria. Again, we don't know about the MLS teams. As I said, the format I think makes sense is for the CanPL teams to have a quarterfinal, semifinal, final week-long event that takes place immediately following the tournament. The winner of that would then advance, in my mind, in an ideal situation to play a winner of an MLS bracket. And I know that excludes anyone else from the tournament, but let's be realistic, people. We're dealing with a pandemic. however the MLS three teams decide it, whether it's based on the points that they gain in the tournament down there, whether they play, Toronto plays Vancouver and the winner plays Montreal because Montreal's the defending champions, that would also be a fair way that they could do it. And then just have the winner of that play the winner of the CanPL side, and then you have the Canadian championship. It's not the tournament we envisioned for this year, but it would be a tournament. So hopefully that will continue, but I think it's a positive sign that they are planning for it, because for many of us, the Voyageurs Cup is a very special tournament, you know, because we paid for it back in the day with, you know, the quarters we found in our couch.
Yes, but also it's a symbol, right? And we love that symbol. It's Canada's biggest soccer trophy that they give around. So not physically the biggest, but you know what I mean, theoretically.
It's actually quite small.
Yeah, well, on the men's side. And I wish one day they'll be the same on the women's side. And that's another topic for another day. Let's take a quick break. When we come back, we'll talk about the Canadian Premier League, the follow-up from yesterday's show, and the return of the prodigal son to York 9 for this year.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sports podcasting network. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. Kevin Laramée with Duane Rollins once again. If you haven't heard at the beginning of the show in the first segment, according to Paul Tenorio of The Athletic, Major League Soccer and the Major League Soccer Players Association have agreed on a new CBA, have voted and ratified for the players the new collective bargaining agreement. There will be a return to play in Orlando. Get all the details on TheAthletic.com, and please subscribe to Paul Tenorio and Sam Stejskal, and of course Jeff Router, three national soccer writers for The Athletic that does great work every single day. And that's one of the great things about these times, is great work from these writers is highlighted, and I kind of like that. But speaking of things that were highlighted, yesterday's show was pretty popular, Duane, and not only popular with the amount of listeners, but it was important conversations, and we had information, we're privy to multiple information regarding what was happening in the Canadian Premier League with the players, the lack of communications and numbers that we were given that we made public on yesterday's show. We had since then multiple confirmations as well, telling us that, yeah, it's not only what you were saying, but we've also heard that there's been some channels of communication that have opened since yesterday. What can you tell us is the latest from yesterday's fallout from the people's reaction of the communication channels between the Canadian Premier League and the players?
I think that the big takeaway is that the union Twitter account tweeted last night late that they had what they called productive discussions with the Canadian Premier League. And then they added it was the first meaningful conversations that they had had with the league since the beginning, since they'd been trying to for months. And look, we can chastise the league, and we did yesterday, for their unwillingness to address the players on a one-to-one equal level through the union, through the association. We can speculate that the reason that they won't do that is based on biases that exist from where the folks that are at the highest levels of this league came from, Tim Hortons, bluntly, who's an anti-union company and not Canadian at all, and certainly not worthy of your flag waving, folks. That's my editorializing there. At any rate, you can editorialize that. You can question, make those statements. But I think what's important right now is that whether, you know, it's unfortunate that it had to happen through shaming, but they do appear to be talking now. So that is a positive, and it does address, and they will hopefully get some of their issues addressed. For, you know, as a quick review, Kevin,
I just want to, sorry, Duane, I just want to mention, we didn't sought off to shame anyone yesterday, though. We were just presented facts, and we just made these facts public. We're just a conduit, and I think that's important, is we never sought off to shame anyone, and that was never used yesterday in the word, and I just want to make it clear that we didn't have any attention. We don't have an agenda. We were shown, we were talked, we were given information, and as journalists, newsworthy information, and we talked about that. So I think it's important also that we were not taking sides, we were just reporting.
Sure. Yes, you're correct. I'm not taking sides. I do actually empathize with the league's position right here. I would suggest that the players, in their decision to leak this to me, were attempting to shame them into talking to the union. So fair enough. That's my opinion. So we'll leave it at that. But the important thing is that they're talking now. And look, a quick review of what the big issues were. The players have concerns over the unilateral nature of the pay cut. They recognize that there is a significant financial challenge for this league and they want it to be successful. They don't think it costs any money to talk to them, though, and to include them in decisions. Sometimes those decisions will ultimately go against the wishes of the players, but at the very least, they won't be blindsided by them, which is what happened. Many people learned of the 25% pay cut through Twitter. Many people learned because it was only a few clubs that had been spoken to when they spoke to me, when the players that reached out to me did so. A lot of the other players, including some prominent players that reached out to me yesterday, heard and learned about this through me. They then went on to learn that, what the information, no one has said that what I said was wrong, other than one email I got in the morning, which they never responded to my reply to. And I, put that out there, the information that the league was denying the full accuracy of the statements. But, I've seen documentation that suggests otherwise. So we don't want to get into it. He said here. But at any rate, they need to talk. And that's happening now. So I don't want to belabor the past. It really is unfortunate that it requires the public airing of this to have them understand the need. And I can't help but think from some of the conversations I had yesterday, Kevin, that which were from people, not players, people close to the league that aren't necessarily at the highest level, that there was a message that got up to the highest level that they needed to relax their hardline stance on it and maybe be a little bit more open to outside opinion and direction. The one constant piece of information I get about how this league is being run at the highest level is that there is a very small group of people at the top that tend to make all the decisions, and the rest of the staff don't, and I'm not a staff and players, don't necessarily feel that they're part of that. The technical staff at the club side really feel at the lunch of that, and had many of them reach out to me over the last year saying stuff I'm reporting, which turns out to be true, is the first they're learning of is through me. And it all speaks to one major thing, Kevin, communication. They need to improve their communication. And that, again, is not about money. That is not about anything other than just telling people what you're thinking and including them in the decision-making process. This is 2020. This is not, Mr. Smythe in the NHL in 1920. Right,
it's not Sam Pollock and the Montreal Canadiens, and I guess that's what they would love, but maybe not. Who knows? Well, we're not here to say anything about that, but that's positive. There is communication, and that's what we can say that is a good thing. And it is role of the media to report newsworthy aspect and to help also things progress, and that's progressing, and that's all we can say, because we want to see the league kick up. We want to see a soccer ball kicked around as much as the next guy and woman.
I just say real quickly, Kevin, the one thing that I constantly got from four or five guys I talked to yesterday is they all stressed how much they want the league to succeed and understand that they might need to make sacrifices to make that happen. The players are on the same side as the owners. This is not a black hat, white hat, give me the money situation here, Kevin. Go ahead.
Yeah, so that's positive. Well, there is at least an open channel of communication, and hopefully things will just continue in that direction moving forward, which will be positive for everyone in soccer in Canada. Let's continue and finish the show talking about York 9 Football Club. Another great signing by York 9. Ryan Telfer, now officially a York 9 player. He returns to York 9 this year. The first scorer for York 9 is back in the Canadian Premier League for their second season. Hopefully we have a chance to see him play. And he's a big get. And he's continuing to show that York 9, if we look back at the last third of the season last year, if you combine both season and thinking of just the last third of that, York 9 were maybe the best team in the league. And they were getting close and close. And this year, maybe they will crack the top two. Maybe they will be a contender for Forge and with Cavalry. Because York 9, with the few signings they've made, and now with the return of Ryan Telfer, are establishing themselves as a definite contender.
Absolutely. I mean, York had a great second half of the season. They were the clear third best team in the league last year, in the league that had a divide between Forge and Cavalry. And then there was a divide to York, and then there was a divide to the rest. That's how I and many see how the league played out. And I think that this signing is a great cherry on top of what has been a really good offseason, both on and off the pitch for York. We had Angus McNabb on the show. Was it the main show, Kevin, or was it two?
It wasn't a main show. It was on Soccer Today, yeah.
Okay. So you can go back to the archives and listen to Angus, who's the managing consultant for Fury York 9. I'm sorry for the giggle there, but he eventually might get a different title. Let's just say that. He's a managing consultant for them, and he has really done some good work to try and reposition that team, and they've done some good stuff related to COVID and related to just trying to keep fan engagement. It's a big job to get fans to York, but one thing that will really help is winning, and I think that team is set up to win. They really are. I haven't sat down to really look at the rosters in detail since March, if you follow. So I'll have to be looking.
Yeah, you're not spending your pandemic looking at York 9, breaking down York 9's depth chart? Come on, Duane, I'm disappointed.
No, I mean, I follow it, but no, I haven't looked at the whole league at all. But I would say that right now, if I'm handicapping this league, and Telfer coming in as a great guy, a good, a player that in many ways epitomizes the need for the CanPL more than anything else. I mean, he has now represented TNT. Internationally, probably because he wasn't good enough to break the Canadian lineup.
Well,
it wasn't
because
Canada wanted him and they lost him. It was basically he decided to go with what he thought was a better choice, and that speaks good for the state of the Canadian program right now. But if you want to look at Ryan Telfer and his baseline talent, I think that if he wasn't getting his first chance at 23 years old and was rather getting his first chance at 19-20 as a professional environment, he was in TFC's academy and was a high prospect in TFC before they loaned him out to York last year, you're probably looking at a guy that might be pushing for a spot in the Canadian setup. So this is an example of how we need this league and how it can move forward. And we don't begrudge Ryan Telfer I don't at least begrudge him from going to TNT. He took an opportunity there, and he's still Canadian in my mind because he's from here, and he's equally part of this league, an important part of this league, and I think he'll be an important part of York, Kevin. And look, quickly, just as a quick another change, this isn't necessarily what we thought we were going to talk about, but let's follow the bouncing ball here for a second. A lot of people will point to the MLS academies and call them failures because they don't graduate a lot of players to Major League Soccer. I look at a player like Ron Telfer, who came through the MLS academies as an example, and it ends up in the CanPL, as an example of the success of the MLS academies in Canada. They need to sign a lot of these guys and see which ones can fight through at the MLS level and not get anything given to them. And then most of those won't. One or two every couple of years might. The rest, if they then find their way into the Canadian Premier League because they were pushed into being better professionals at a higher level, and MLS is, that's a success, and that's how the MLS Academy should work, and that's how the Canadian system and its ad hoc way it's set up should work. And I think it's an example. You can look at Ryan Telfer as a great example of how the system ideally will work moving forward, just hopefully a little quicker in the case of players like him.
If we truly do a deep dive re-roster of the Canadian Premier League and look at all the players that have a tie to a Major League Soccer Academy in Canada, it'd be, half the league? Like, easily. Because they've either trained with them for a few weeks, Canadian soccer is is a big community. It's coast to coast. It's big. But at the elite playing level, like MLS Academy or not, and you have a chance to go there. And if you don't, you go there. Like, if you go, we've talked about the Bundesliga a lot. So let's use Alfonso Davies. And it all started with him, with like an indoor soccer academy that has nothing to do with the other ones. But everyone knows each other. And if someone's discovered, they're going to pass him through. It's bigger than each parts, right? A player like a Davies, or if you want to use a big name from any academy in Canada, whatever, is more important than that academy or that team, and that goes to that. And of course, they're not going to be that. It's a very, what, it's 0.0001% of players that are Alfonso Davies of this world, but you'll have a lot more Joel Waterman or Ryan Telfer, and that's all right. That's great. That's the actual job of an academy, is to create players like that, that with the academy they're able to be professional, and without the academy they might not be. Alfonso Davies would have been discovered and probably anywhere he would have played, right? And that's the beauty, sure, of these type of talent. Wayne Gretzky would have been discovered if he was Australian. Maybe he would have played a different game, but he would have been discovered. But I think that's one of the beauty of the academies, is making professional out of players that would not have been professional if it wasn't for that academy.
I'm going to give an analogy as a final thought for today. I view the Canadian system as a mini Portugal. And stay with me for a second. You look at the Portugal, obviously there's two leagues operating in the country, and that's unique to anywhere in the world. That's at a Wales, so we're in New Zealand. So let's put that on a shelf. But in general, think about Portugal for a second. Portugal's got three big teams, and they've got one team bigger than the other two. No offense, Impact and Whitecaps fans. That's the situation we have in Canada right now. We have three big teams that are clearly much bigger than the rest. We have one of those big teams that right now, anyway, is clearly bigger, just a step above them, too. So you have those three academies that are working to grind and gobbling up all of the young talent at a young age and seeing which ones come out of their meat grinder. Most of those players don't, but they do disperse across the rest of the Portuguese league. And every so often that system produces Cristiano Ronaldo or Alfonso Davies in our case.
Yeah.
So if we can, and it's a middling power, right? Like Portugal is. It's within the football world, it certainly is.
So when are we winning the Gold
Cup?
But it's
a power that has rose up and has played above its weight. And if we can do that as Canada, I think that there are worst examples we can follow.
So Portugal won the Euro in 2016. Are you saying we're going to win the next Gold Cup? Is that what we need to compare Canada to? Come on.
Sure.
Vamos, vai Canada, vai Canada. We win the Euro. Well, our version, so the Gold Cup.
Yeah, a little better chance of that happening than there ever was Portugal winning it for 3 years and years when you look at their size. But yes, it's you know, there's a lot of differences between Portugal and Canada too, clearly. I'm not, you know, trying to be literal here, but I do think that if you look at that sort of three big clubs and then the rest of the leagues being much smaller with no chance really of ever being the best club, but certainly can compete and can rise up from time to time and have opportunity to play them in cup games. And it's a system that I think that it works in places. I don't think there's a problem that we have three clubs that are above and beyond the rest, and that we have right now eight other clubs. Hopefully that grows to something closer to 16 clubs that are at that level, and then those three big clubs, and I think you're basically the same as the rest of the world at that point.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. It's positive strive, you know. It's always a fascinating time, and things change quickly, right, from day to day. You never know what can happen. We almost went from a lockout on Monday to a CBA being ratified in Major League Soccer. We went from players feeling like they're not listened to in the Canadian Premier League to channel of communications now being open, players re-signing. Things change quickly, and who knows, maybe before long we'll have, like you say, more and more players being sold out of the Canadian Premier League and more academies, and everything was going to be better, and we'll have more players like Ryan Telfer choosing to come back in the Canadian Premier League. Congratulations to Ryan Telfer and York 9 on this re-signing, or whichever label you want to put on his return to York 9. Congratulations to everyone involved. Thanks for listening. And once again, if you want to have more details on what we talked about in the beginning of the show, Major League Soccer and Major League Soccer Player Associations have agreed on a new CBA. It's been ratified. I strongly suggest you go to theathletic.com and you read Paul Tenorio, Sam Stejskal, and of course, Jeff Router's work on theathletic.com. We'll be back tomorrow with another edition of The World of Soccer with, well, The World of Football with a soccer perspective, of course. Tomorrow's Friday. We'll look at what's happening this weekend in the Bundesliga, in the K-League. We'll also give you an update on the latest in the world of North American soccer. But as always, until tomorrow, have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.